Good evening, everyone. The doors of St. Alfred Parish are open wide to welcome each and every one, with a special acknowledgement to all who are visiting our parish community. During this prayerful time together, may we encounter Jesus and experience the joy of his presence. During Lent, we will have Stations of the Cross in Spanish every Wednesday at 7 p.m., followed by Mass in Spanish. Stations in English will be every Friday at 6:30 p.m., followed by Mass in English at 7 p.m. There is a schedule change for Stations of the Cross in Italian. Stations of the Cross in Italian will be at 6:30, followed by Mass in Italian at 7 p.m., every Tuesday during Lent. There are Create Hope prayer cards available for pickup at the entrances of the church. On the back of this card is a prayer for the Development and Peace Share Lent campaign. Beginning Monday, February the 26th, we will be hosting a symbol and video series every Monday evening at 6:30 in St. Mark's Room for 5 weeks. Topics will include the sacraments, the Mass, penance, anointing of the sick, matrimony, holy orders, a love that lasts, and Catholic social teaching. All are welcome. St. Alfred's monthly pasta dinner is this Wednesday, February the 28th, in St. Mark's Room from 4:30 to 7 p.m. $15 for adults and $8 for children includes 3 meatballs, pasta, salad, and dessert. Tea, coffee, or a cold beverage is also included. Takeout is available, and tickets are available at the door. Inserted in this week's bulletin is the parish financial statement for 2023. Today is the second Sunday of Lent. Growing in faith and understanding is a lifelong process. It is reflected in each of our personal lives, just as it was reflected with Judaism and Christianity. God's covenant with Israel was expressed in many dramatic ways to increase their understanding. And the disciples and those who followed them learned slowly who Jesus is. Lent is an opportunity for us to focus on who Jesus is for each of us. Before we begin our celebration of the Mass, we would like everyone to warmly greet those around them. Hi, everyone. And our celebrant today will be Monsignor Hugh.
Thank you. are my God, you alone are my joy. Defend me, O Lord. Glad are my heart and my soul, securely my body shall rest.
Of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be always with you. Good evening, everyone. My brothers and sisters in Christ, to prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries, let us first of all pause and call to mind our sins. God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting. Let us pray. O God, who have commanded us to listen to your beloved Son, be pleased, we pray, to nourish us inwardly by your word, that with spiritual sight made pure, we may rejoice to behold your glory. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Genesis. God tested Abraham. He said to him, Abraham. And Abraham said, Here I am. God said, Take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah, and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I shall show you. When Abraham and Isaac came to the place that God had shown him, Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to kill his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, Here I am. The angel said, Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him, for now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in the thicket by its horns. Abraham went up and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. The angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time from heaven and said, "By myself I have sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will indeed bless you, and I will make your offspring as numerous as the stars of heaven and as the sand that is on the seashore. And your offspring shall possess the gate of their enemies, and by your offspring shall all the nations of the earth gain blessing for themselves, because you have obeyed my voice." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I will walk in the presence of the Lord, in the land of the living. I will walk in the presence of the Lord, in the land of the living. Trusted even when they said, "I am sorely afflicted." Oh, precious in the eyes of the Lord is the death of his faithful. I will walk in the presence of the Lord, in the land of the living. Your servant, Lord, your servant am I. You have loosened my bonds. A thanksgiving sacrifice I make. I will call on the Lord's name. I will walk the presence of the Lord in the land of the living. My vows to the Lord I will fulfill before all his peoples in the courts of the house of the Lord. In your midst, O Jerusalem, I will walk in the presence of the Lord, in the land of the living.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, if God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charges against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, who is the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword. No, in all these we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark. Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." Peter didn't know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice. "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. So they kept the matter to themselves, questioning what this rising from the dead could mean. The Gospel of the Lord. Honeymoon. The two words that compose it tell its story. The first month of marriage is the sweetest, the honey part. Then comes the moon, at first full and bright, but eventually it wanes. So does the initial affection of a married couple. And we all comment, the honeymoon is over. Only the immature, the really spiritually immature, think that the honeymoon can or should last forever. So in vain they work hard to preserve it. They strive to do the impossible, to hold on to the honeymoon, the moment, the youth, the frozen image of perfection, to always stay on top or near the top. But as most common sense people know, life isn't lived only at the top. It's lived in the hills of monotony, in the fields of work, in the valleys of disappointment, and mostly on the plains of quiet devotion, love, and sacrifice, which in the end brings one full circle to a depth of love never envisaged, nor even possible on the honeymoon. If you've ever met devoted golden jubilarians, you know what real love really is. But the temptation is to settle into fantasy land, to dream of remaining young forever, to idolize and freeze the 15 minutes of fame, and is highly promoted by a highly efficient advertising industry that endlessly promises us to eliminate everything that might end the honeymoon for a price, of course. As you just heard in the Gospel, St. Peter succumbed to the temptation. Dazzled by the mountaintop transfiguration, he exclaimed, "Let's settle here and make three dwellings and live happily ever after." But it was not to be, it could not be, and he was hit by reality. That was it. Just like that, it was all gone. The celebrities Moses and Elijah, the voice from the cloud, the dazzling strobe lights. Only Jesus was left. And he would matter-of-factly speak of death, about his resurrection as they came down from the mountain off the honeymoon. Jesus brings his disciples back down to earth by speaking about being raised from the dead, which will mean facing the cross. Likewise, we need to take up our crosses daily to follow him, which is to say, make your crucial decisions to be faithful, honest, trustworthy, just, merciful, and forgiving in the everydayness of life. The celebrity moments are nice, enjoy them, but don't get stuck there, for they don't last, nor are they meant to last. A poor man living in a hostel in Toronto told the following story. Once he was walking along the street. At a certain point, he found himself standing outside St. Michael's Cathedral. Before he realized it, he was inside the church. He couldn't recall whether or not he said any prayers, but his soul was flooded with light. His depression lifted and a great peace descended upon him. He felt he had a place in this life after all. He felt close to God and loved by God. The experience seemed to last for a long time. Yet he had a feeling it may have lasted only for a few minutes. But he said he'd give the whole of his life for those few moments. What made the experience so wonderful was the realization that he had done absolutely nothing to deserve it. It was a pure gift from God to him. For one short moment, he tasted glory. However, when it was all over, he found himself outside in the streets once more, going along aimlessly as before. The effects of the experience faded. Though he went back to the church many times afterwards, he was never able to recapture that moment. The homeless man wanted to hold on to that experience. He wanted to go backwards instead of forwards. He might have used the experience to illuminate the darkness of his life and to go forward more hopeful and courageous. Peter made the same mistake. He wanted to stay on the mountaintop. He wanted to hug and hold on to the blessedness of the experience. He didn't want to go back down to the everydayness and the common things again, but to remain forever in the enchanted land. But Jesus summoned him to go back down the mountain and to face the future. The experience was not meant to provide an escape from the struggle that lay ahead, but to help him face it head on. The hour of light was meant to help him face the hour of darkness. Yet it's clear that something of the wonder of that day remained with Peter and illuminated his life, because many, many years later, he could write, "We were eyewitnesses of his glory on the mountain. A voice came to him saying, 'This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.'" We too can experience rare moments of light and joy. We get glimpses of the promised land towards which we are all traveling in faith. In his love for us, God allows us to taste on earth the joys of the world to come. But these moments of transfiguration are given to us to strengthen us for our everyday tasks and enable us to face the cross, which in some shape or form comes to everyone. The moment of glory does not exist for its own sake. It exists to clothe the common things with the radiance they never had before. Prayer and religion are not escapism. They are meant to help us face life with all its difficulties and challenges, to embrace the highs and the low moments of life, the hilltops and the valleys. What's the bottom line? The honeymoon is wonderful, but the moon must wane. The mountaintop is exhilarating, but the plains is where it's at. The transfiguration is a lift, but in the end, being alone with Jesus Christ in the plains is really where it's at.
Let us stand and together recite the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints,
resurrection of bodies, and life everlasting. Amen.
We pray that our own faith and understanding of Jesus may be strengthened during this Lenten season.
Our response is, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the whole church, that we may be an ever-learning community, open to God's ongoing revealing word, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those seeking to enter into or more deeply engage in the church, and for all who have questions of faith, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a new and deeper understanding of how our faith compels us to act on behalf of the poor and marginalized, the persecuted and the suffering, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those whose deepened faith has been expressed at great personal cost, for contemporary martyrs, courageous witnesses, and all persecuted Christians, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those preparing to celebrate the sacraments of baptism, confirmation, and Eucharist, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the church's teachers, preachers, and theologians who continue to stretch and challenge our understanding, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
for young farmers in Canada and around the world, that they may have access to farmland and the resources they need to develop its potential and meet the food needs of their communities. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all the sick, especially the parishioners who have asked for our prayers. We ask the Lord Jesus to lay his healing hands upon them and assure them of his abiding presence at this difficult time. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, especially Gerald Gorman, Teresa Aguirre Galliano, and Hunter DiCicco, and for their families and friends who grieve them with love. And at this Mass, we remember Donald Hall and Jeff Jacobs. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, you revealed yourself to us throughout history, and most especially through your beloved Son. Open our hearts and minds to understand you and Jesus even more deeply during this Lenten season. And we make this prayer through the same Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Pray, my friends, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May this sacrifice, O Lord, we pray, cleanse us of our faults and sanctify your faithful in body and mind, for the celebration of the Paschal festivities through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For after he had told the disciples of his coming death, on the holy mountain he manifested to them his glory, to show even by the testimony of the law and the prophets that the passion leads to the glory of the resurrection. And so with the powers of heaven, we worship you constantly on earth, and before your majesty without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, that they may become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church, spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Gerard our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our sisters and brothers who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, Saint Alfred, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us offer each other a sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. For those attending Mass online, the act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Brother, feed us now.
Let us pray. As we receive these glorious mysteries, we make thanksgiving to you, O Lord, for allowing us, while still on earth, to be partakers even now of the things of heaven through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Let us bow our heads and pray for God's blessing. Bless your faithful, we pray, O Lord, with a blessing that endures forever, and keep them faithful to the gospel of your only begotten Son, so that they may always desire and at last attain that glory whose beauty he showed in his own body to the amazement of his apostles through Christ our Lord. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Mass is ended. Let us go in peace.
Thank you.